Okay friends, welcome to the second phase. In this second phase, we will continue talking about what we have done before. We have seen that network layer is divided into phases and into layers, and why those layers and what is the problem with those layers. Let us try to look further into it. Okay. There are two models which are used and prescribed by the authors and designers. The TCP/IP model is the model that is being used by almost all of us, and OSI model is actually nowhere in use, but we are mentioning it just for the sake of terminology, because the terminology of OSI is being used almost everywhere. Anyway, and there is one critical difference between OSI model and the TCP/IP model, you can see, which is being highlighted. There are two layers. Application layer is common in both OSI as well as TCP/IP, but the OSI model had presentation and session layer, which does not exist in TCP/IP model. Transport layer exists in both models, network layer exists in both models, data link also exists in both models, and physical also exists in both models. In TCP/IP model, basically data link and physical are combined together in form of the network card, but we will still talk about these two as layers because functionally they are different, and we will be looking at what those their functions are. Here are some comparison between OSI and TCP. You can see that the number of layers, OSI had 7 and TCP/IP is 5. Data delivery system is connection oriented in OSI, while TCP/IP was connectionless. What does that mean? That means that before sending something, it establishes connection, telling the other end that I am sending. When the other party says yes, you do, then it sends. Okay, that is called connection oriented. When you do not do it, it is called connectionless. So, OSI was predominantly designed with connection oriented model of delivery, TCP/IP exactly other way around. And OSI had very few protocols available, and TCP/IP had all protocols because it is basically a working protocol. OSI has never been a working protocol. And in the OSI model, you have this distinction between data link as well as the physical layer, which is non-existent in TCP architecture, though we said we will be using that. Okay. One of the critical design component of TCP/IP model is called connection oriented service over connectionless delivery. Now, let us try to understand the meaning of this, which is very, very critical. Okay. In this connection oriented service, as I said, there is a phase called connection establishment process. So, sender's TCP or the transport layer communicates with receiver's TCP and establishes a connection. Okay. What does that mean? It's asking for connection, sending connection request and getting the response. Then it transfers data and then it terminates the connection. Okay. In fact, the connection establishment process, after that the data transfer process which takes care, which actually happens using connectionless delivery mechanism. How that happens? We have sender, we have receiver, and assuming that there are two routers in between, what will that do? It starts sending things in form of something called a packet, and here we have a packet being sent. You can see that the packet is sent, it goes to router 1, router 2, and then the receivers. You can see that in this particular process, sender send to receiver router 1, router 1 to router 2, and router 2 to receiver. This entire process happens without establishing any form of connection. So, though TCP establishes connection, the IP which is running beneath does not establish connection and deliver everything in connectionless model. That is why this is called connection oriented service over connectionless delivery model. Why this model is adopted is very interesting, we will be looking at this little later. Okay. Now, let us talk about each layer in turn. We start with the physical layer and try to see what the job of this physical layer is. Both the physical as well as the data link layer resides on interface cards, and that is why we have shown them as the cards. Okay. The physical layer receives bits from the data link layer, something like this, and that is actually converted into some form of signals, which how we will be looking at later. Now, these signals are sent to receiver. Again, by the physical layer, it is converted to bits and given to data link layer. That is the job of the physical layer. Basically, the job of physical layer is to carry bits across in form of signals. Okay. Now, what is the job of data link layer? Again, as I said, detailing layer and physical layer, both of them reside on the card, network interface card. So, they are shown as senders and receivers. So, it receives from the higher layer called network layer, get some data. So, data link layer constructs something called frame out of that data. It adds a header, adds a trailer. What those header and trailer are right now, we will not discuss, but there is something. And once this is done, it is called frame. Now, that frame is sent across. Obviously, we have already seen that data link layer on its own cannot send it. So, this frame is converted into signals and sent to the other end by the physical layer. And the receiver's data link layer would receive it. Eventually, the sender data link layer sends this frame, and this receiver data link layer receives this frame. Okay. So, like this. Okay. Now, that is again from that frame, the content is delivered to the network layer. Okay. So, this is a simple job of data link layer. Okay. But the network layer, which runs on top of it, it is very, very different. What does it do? Let us try to see through this simulation. There are few things which the sender wants to send, and there are few packets. You can see that they are traveling across the line R1, R2, R3. These are all routers, and you can see that some of them are traveling on one path, some packets travel on some other path. You can see that. Who decides this? The network layer. The network layer actually decides how the packet will travel. Which path will it take? You can see that every packet is taking a different path. Okay. At the end of the simulation, all the packets, almost all the packets, will travel at the other end. Okay. So, that is basically the job of network layer, decide the route for every packet which travels across. Okay. Now, what is the job of network layer? In summary, the transport layer gives the content which is coming again from the application layer, eventually which is given to it by the user. Okay. So, that content, network layer adds a header to it, and this thing is called a packet, and this thing is sent across. The packet is sent across. We have seen those packets moving across, but these packets cannot move on their own. So, they are normally embedded in a frame and then sent across, and again frame cannot travel on their own. We have seen that those frames will travel in form of signals. Okay. So, that is how it actually works. And the content of packets is delivered to recipient's transport layer. But then there is a twist. Point is, if this network layer belongs to a router, then this is not the receiver actually, it is to be routed. Remember, we have seen that these packets move across. Okay. So, in that case, at this point of time, instead of going to the receiver's transport layer, it goes to the data link layer, because it has to be sent further. It is not to be accepted, it is to be routed. So, when it goes to the network layer, it will go further up. Okay. So, with that note, we conclude this particular phase. In this phase, what we have seen? We have seen how our packets move around, what is the job of the network layer, what is the job of detailing layer, and what is the job of physical layer. Physical layer's job is to move signals across, detailing layer is to construct frame out of the packet which is given to it by the network layer. Okay. So, that is what the job of these three layers are, and in the next phase, we will be looking at the functions of other layers as well. With that note, we conclude. Thanks, folks.